Good morning, friends, and welcome to this service of worship on this Lord's Day. We greet you from St. Paul United Methodist Church, downtown Ocean Springs. Thank you for joining us for worship.
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel His mighty power and His grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
Please join me for the prayer call to worship. O God, you have bound us together in this life. Give us grace to understand how our lives depend on the courage, industry, the honesty, and the integrity of all who labor. May we be mindful of their needs, grateful for their faithfulness, and faithful in our responsibilities to them, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The hymn is number 144, This Is My Father's World.
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world, I rest me. Skies and seas, His hand the wonders wrought. This is my Father's world. The birds their carols raise, the morning light, the lilies white, declare their Maker's praise. This is my Father's world, He shines in all that's fair. In the rustling grass I hear Him pass, He speaks to me everywhere. This is my Father's world, oh let me
Affirmation of Faith is number 881, the Apostles' Creed. Let us unite together in this historic confession. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day He rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now and ever.
We now gather our thoughts together as God's people as we prepare to pray, and we covet your prayer concerns, your needs and joys. Please share those as you would like. Contact us through email or by phone. Also, you'll see the information for our prayer ministry. Please take advantage of that as you would like to. You can be sure when you share a request that it's prayed for diligently by folks at St. Paul who help with that ministry. We have had a lot going on in our country as well as our lives. And during this Labor Day weekend, we remember and give thanks for all our blessings, but of course, hold up our continued prayers for those who are reeling from the pandemic, who are experiencing difficulty, maybe physically, health-wise, or economically, as well as those who are in the path of Hurricane Laura these last few days, who are trying to recover their lives from that, as well as others affected by wildfires out west. We hold all of these, as well as our personal prayers, up during this time. Let us pray. Eternal God, we praise you today that you are the one who labored in the beginning to initiate creation and to bring to being the life and love of this your world, this world we call home. We honor you this day, giving thanks to you for this same gift of life and love, seeking to open ourselves anew to the significance of work and the blessing of work and the place of it in our lives. When it comes to work and our labor, we thank you that though our accomplishments are temporary, our relationship with you is eternal. And that although we do not always see, nor can we determine the final outcome of our efforts, you are in ultimate control of your creation. Today we pray for help in keeping our priorities straight, for keeping our work in balance with other aspects of the life you provide, for joy in doing whatever share of work is ours to do, for understanding the value of working and the wisdom in its rhythm, and for trust that what we do is an important contribution in your great scheme of things. We pray for help for those who are without work, for all who are unemployed, who would like to work, but who cannot. We pray for courage to make a change for those who feel bound in jobs for which they are not suited or satisfied. We do remember those who are reeling from the effects of COVID or other illnesses. We remember healthcare workers of all kinds who are serving during this time. We remember and lift up to you those who have been affected by hurricanes and other natural disasters. Be with them and strengthen them. Help those who come to their aid to be able to find ways to do that in ways that make a difference. We pray for an awareness of our eternal worth for those who judge themselves of lesser worth because they cannot do the work they once did or would like to do. We pray for all who suffer in mind, body, or spirit, asking that you would give them your peace, you would strengthen and relieve them in their time of need, that they may find comfort in your presence and your eternal love. So today, receive our offering of praise and show us where love and hope and faith are needed, and use us to bring them to those places. We ask all these things in the name of Christ our Lord, as we also together pray the words he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We come to the time of offering in our service, and we give thanks that we may respond with ourselves and our gifts to the God whose love never fails us. A simple reminder that one easy way to give, if you are worshiping online with us today, is electronically, and if you would go to give.stpaulos.org, You may have done this before, but if not, it's easy to navigate. Just click on the links that link you to giving to the general fund, our church that supports our church and its ministries. But also, if you'd like to support hurricane relief, there's a place for that too. And now we have shifted that link for hurricane relief for collecting for specific things that will be taken and shared with those affected by Hurricane Laura. The old-fashioned way works as well. P.O. Box 909, Ocean Springs, Mississippi, St. Paul United Methodist. Let us pray together. Almighty God, we give you thanks and praise for your love shown to us in Jesus Christ our Lord. Accept the offering of our lives in union with Christ's offering for us, and make us humble and obedient servants who will work for your good pleasure through Christ with the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Praise God, from whom the blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
surrender. Now I feel the sacred flame. Oh, the joy of full salvation. Glory, glory to his name. I surrender all. I surrender all.
We have two scripture lessons for this Labor Day weekend Sunday today from the Old Testament, Ecclesiastes chapter 2, 18 through 26, followed by 1 Corinthians 12, 4 through 11. Ecclesiastes 2, beginning verse 18. I hated all my toil in which I had toiled under the sun, seeing that I must leave it to those who come after me, and who knows whether they will be wise or foolish. Yet they will be master of all for which I toiled and used my wisdom under the sun. This also is vanity. So I turned and gave my heart up to despair concerning all the toil of my labors under the sun, because sometimes one who has toiled with wisdom and knowledge and skill must leave all to be enjoyed by another who did not toil for it. This also is vanity and a great evil. What do mortals get from all the toil and strain from which they toil under the sun? For all their days are full of pain, and their work is a vexation. Even at night their minds do not rest. This also is vanity. There is nothing better for mortals than to eat and drink and find enjoyment in their toil. This also I saw is from the hand of God. For apart from him, who can eat or who can have enjoyment? For to one who pleases him, God gives wisdom and knowledge and joy, but to the sinner he gives the work of gathering and heaping, only to give to the one who pleases God. This also is vanity and chasing after wind. From the New Testament, we look to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 4 through 11. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom. To another, the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another, working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, the discernment of spirits. To another, various kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit who allots to each one individually, just as the Spirit chooses. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. I remember having a conversation with my dear mother some years ago, who's 85 now, a very wise woman. I've always considered her wise. And this particular time, we were talking about how some people, you know, are born into, come from disadvantaged homes and situations with many strikes against them, yet somehow find a way to overcome them and flourish and prosper, while other people who seem to have, you know, many advantages at the get-go have trouble navigating life. I think we were talking about this because I know we talked about that multiple times, but I remember her saying one of those times, and it's the quote I want to share with you today. She said, I think there are three things that are very important for every young person growing up, and I would add for every adult growing up as well. Three important things in life. One is to live within your means. Two, to be comfortable in your own skin. And three, to find something you enjoy working on or are good at. Now, as we consider the place of work in our lives for this Labor Day weekend, and indeed the title of the message is Labor of Love, as we consider what that may be, let us consider the voice also of Ecclesiastes, who says, There's nothing better for mortals than to eat and drink and find enjoyment in their toil. That's one of the more mild things he says, but let's stay with that for a moment. John Buchanan, who was pastor of Fourth Presbyterian Church for years, remembers his father, has a memory of his father that's vivid that he shares. And he says, "I do not recall seeing my father cry often, but on one occasion it impressed me so deeply I've never forgotten it." He said, he explained that his father was a fireman for the Pennsylvania Railroad in the days when that meant 8 hours of shoveling coal. Can you imagine 8 straight hours of shoveling coal into the firebox of a steam locomotive? And so it was back-breaking work, and he would come home dirty, you know, with coal dust. That's the way all those firemen came home at the end of work. But it was a job that he was glad to have because it sustained the family. But Buchanan goes on to mention that thankfully before he died, his father was promoted to engineer in the time of diesel locomotives and enjoyed not only that added responsibility, but not coming home all covered with dirt and dust. The incident he remembers in particular, though, was during the recession periods in which they lived in the early 1940s and 50s. The economy had slowed down, and so did the railroad and the shops that were the primary source of employment for the whole community. And many men who had had jobs were laid off, and they stood in line for unemployment, and everybody virtually that they knew was affected. And it seemed like, he said, everybody's father was out of work. So many tried to find alternative jobs, ushering in theaters or janitoring or pumping gas, but there wasn't nearly enough of those to go around. And people, as you may imagine, were anxious and frightened. I mean, the memory of the Great Depression was still with them. And so after a while, the government became involved and provided surplus food. It made that available. But to get it, you had to stand in line and you had to verify your unemployed status. And it was very difficult, maybe somewhat demeaning for Mr. Buchanan Sr. to do that. Finally, though, he swallowed his pride and stood in line and brought home a government parcel, and it had staples of butter and cheese and flour, dried milk, and then cans of beef stew, which Buchanan says was really simply awful, talking about the food itself. He said, "My mother tried to make an adventure of it, fix it up the best she could, but it was still awful." And each family member at dinner time one night when they had the beef stew was kind of pushing it around on their plates. He said he remembered his father, without a word, getting up, taking up the plates from the table, scraping the beef stew into the kitchen garbage, and then going into the living room where he promptly sat down and put his head in his hands and wept. Now, we'll come back to John Buchanan's story there. But let's talk about work. Americans, more than any other people on earth, have this kind of love-hate relationship with work. And that's probably, or at least partly, because more than any other people on earth, I'm talking about the nations, we seek and establish our identity on the basis of our jobs. We really do so much. You know, again, ask who we are. We're liable to answer that much of the time, telling you what we do, how we earn our money, our living. Now, on the one hand, 80% of American people say they would continue to work even if they didn't have to. But on the other hand, something like 95% of people say they don't like their jobs. Incidentally, Dr. Walter Wink, who's professor of Auburn Seminary, says that the highest incidence of heart attacks occur on Monday morning. Guess what time? He says between 8 and 9 a.m., yeah, when people are returning to work from the weekend. Work is a complicated topic, and it's made more complex by the fact that our faith tradition itself says different things about it. This book of Ecclesiastes was written several centuries before Christ by this man who obviously was kind of philosopher and preacher. And he reflects on this eternal question of the meaning of life. And we know this philosopher, mostly because of his lovely prose. You know, we know about, or have heard words from chapter 3, "For everything there is a season and a time for every purpose, every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to mourn and a time to dance." But he also seems to be a cynic, or at least he has that side in him. "There's nothing new under the sun," he says. "Vanity of vanities, all is vanity." And when he reflects on the topic of work, he becomes almost wistful. "I hated all my toil in which I had toiled under the sun. Besides," he adds, "I'm going to have to turn my work over to people who won't even do it like I do it. And who knows whether they will be wise or foolish. They will be master for all, of all, for which I worked. This also is vanity." And finally, in verse 24, he makes this profound, some would say good, observation. "There's nothing better for mortals than to eat and drink and find enjoyment in their toil." Now, it occurs to me that right there, as you and I have observed, or maybe hopefully experienced, that one of the greatest blessings in life, perhaps reserved for the most fortunate of us, is going to work on Monday morning or whenever you go to a job that you really mostly love. Even if you mostly like it or love, that's a big plus, you know, to be paid. Now, we sometimes exaggerate and say, "I would do it for nothing." But whether that's an exaggeration or nothing, to find enjoyment in your toil in that way, what a wonderful blessing. But here's the truth about it. Enjoyment in our toil, it is or can be an elusive blessing. Buchanan's father did not experience it until the end of his life, and many people never experience it. Among those, you know, in today's plight, who are fortunate enough to be gainfully employed, and we remember them in our prayers and our nation and world. Now, some people put work in a whole different category from their faith, and that's really a problem. That really has its problems, not least of which is that, you know, work itself is kind of neutral. It can be good work or bad work. And what I mean by bad is I'm not talking about the level, you know, of how it's looked upon as far as whether it's prestigious or not. I'm talking about work that can create more of a dark world or a dark night for the world, that contributes to the devastation of the planet, to the despair of the young and the old, to hoarding when we should be sharing, to putting people down instead of lifting them up. And you see, our faith tradition, the Hebrew Christian tradition, is based on the conviction that human beings are created in the image of God. And it proclaims that we have value because we were born with this image within us. Now, do you believe that or not? I'm not just talking about the way you would stand up and say the Apostles' Creed. Do you believe it or not? Because if your belief system begins with that, it's going to inform you a lot about the place of work and what we would consider our own labor of love. Created in God's image means we human beings, regardless of who we are, regardless of our situation in life, each really deserve respect and dignity and compassion and care and love. So consequently, anything that demeans or humiliates or puts down human beings is not condoned or blessed. Even, I dare say, if it has to be said, even if it is marketable or profitable. Now, to put it more simply from the mouth of one ethicist, we have lost something essential to our humanity if the only issue is profit. This has all kinds of implications for our work and for our living. Have you noticed how the workplace quietly has done this, and sometimes not so quietly, but just invaded the rest of life? And I'm not talking about this point in time during the pandemic where people have had to work remotely as they can, you know, by necessity. I'm not referring to that. This is long before any of that started happening. The cell phone allows the man sitting behind me at the high school football game to carry on this running dialogue with his office, you know, for two quarters of the football game. You walk into any hotel lobby or airport, shopping center, it's full of people talking loudly on their cell phones, not just having a good time, but trying to do business and everything else. Even restaurants. There was this cartoon that showed a man wearing a business suit. He was all alone at his table with his cell phone in place. And, you know, next to him in a booth were two ladies who were obviously having a good time talking. And he says, "Be quiet, I'm trying to make a deal." There was a New York Times editorial for Labor Day some years ago that pointed to the fact that Americans have surpassed the Japanese in the number of hours on the job. They mentioned Japanese because the Japanese had set the bar some time back for that, but we had even surpassed them. That means we surpassed everybody for the number of hours we work each week and each month. And the article went on to say we're working more, but guess what? Enjoying it much less. That doesn't mean we've always been the fact that we work so many hours the smartest or the most humane in our lives and in our work. In fact, you know, the present hard data of COVID infection rates and deaths, our country, compared to other countries, doesn't look so hot. Consequently, you know, many of our health professionals feel that they must work and work and work hours on end in this season to keep people alive. And that's what they're doing, many of them. God bless them. So work can definitely go astray. We've seen that. We probably experienced that. What then about Ecclesiastes' suggestion that there is nothing better than finding enjoyment in our toil? Do you agree, first of all? And if so, how do you find joy in your work? Now, I know sometimes it's simply a change of activity in finding joy in work that you're used to. It's not to make money, but the change in activity is kind of renewing. I've experienced that. Well, let's talk about work, whether it's, as we say, making a living or the other labors of love in our lives. This important biblical word from St. Paul comes to us. There are varieties of gifts, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone, and to each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. Each is given a gift, a skill, an ability to put to work for the common good. No one is left out. There is work for everyone, a special labor of love that God gives to each of us, to us all. Mm. Everyone has a work, a project, a special task that is ours and ours alone, for which we uniquely and individually have been equipped by God. And this takes the third thing my mom said, you know, to find something you enjoy working on and are good at, and expands it perhaps even more. Perhaps the most important task for each of us is to identify or discover and work on our project, our labor of love. And what a blessing if we can earn a living doing that, but not everyone can. Sometimes our job is the means by which we earn enough money to do our work and our vocation and our labor of love. Sometimes it works differently. There's a great piece, a book that's a travelogue from years ago. The title is Blue Highways by William Least Heat Moon. And Moon travels across this land of ours with his dog, visiting little towns and byways in the United States, including Why Not, Mississippi. And he runs into an elderly gentleman, and the conversation turns to work. And the old gentleman says, "A man's never out of work if he's worth a darn. It's just sometimes he doesn't get paid. I've gone unpaid my share. I've pulled my share of pay. But that's not got nothing to do with working. A man's work is doing what he's supposed to do." I think the older man said it well. What is that for you? What is your special, unique labor of love? Our common vocation is to live as followers of Jesus Christ. That we all share. When we seriously put heart and mind to that vocation, we see how deeply and passionately Jesus loved the world. So following him means being like that, caring deeply and passionately about the world and the people in it. It's also about loving the people that God gives us, has given us to love, and loving our neighbor, God's precious gift. The Fred Bigner quote is wonderful. The place God calls you to is the place where your deep gladness and the world's deep hunger meet. Now, that will be different for each of us. As St. Paul observed, some will teach, some will sing, some will write, some will plant trees, some will heal, some will teach children to become all they can become, some will argue cases, some will advocate in the political arena, some will deliver meals, some will wash dishes, some will clean sheets. But each has a project, a labor of love. And that's why I find Buchanan's story about his father so compelling. He said he would never forget the night his father cried because his father sensed that he was humiliated. It must have seemed to his father, with his children eating government surplus food, that he was not the man he wanted to be, unemployed, unable to provide in the way he wanted. But, and this is the key point, Buchanan points out, his job did not limit or ultimately define him. Buchanan said his labor of love was his determination to live and experience every day from sunrise to starry night, and that he passed on that love and determination to his children. If he had to name and see a visible project, it was his garden, flowering plants procured from the gardens of friends, lovingly planted, tended after work or days off. Sometimes he took his entire 2-week vacation to work in it. It's what he loved in his life. And his son, now an older man himself, reflects back on this, continues to be reminded of his father's project and to be grateful every time he sees the irises bloom in spring, because among them are his iris that his father would take wherever they lived and moved and replant. Now, we all need those reminders. And because I believe my mother was right, it is good to live within one's means, to be comfortable within one's own skin, to find something you enjoy working on or are good at. And I think she was maybe saying more than she may have realized at the time, because I, like you, have seen that iris bloom many times over in my life. And it is a reminder that God is at work and has work for each of us to do that matters to him, and that is all part of the great economy of creation, our own labor of love. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our final hymn and hymn of invitation is number 128, He Leadeth Me, O Blessed Thought. Let us sing together.
He leadeth me, O blessed thought, O words with heavenly comfort fraught. Whate'er I do, where'er I be, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, He leadeth me, by His own hand He leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by His hand He leadeth me. Sometimes it seems of deepest gloom, sometimes where Eden's bowers bloom, by water still or troubled sea, still 'tis His hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, He leadeth me, by His own hand He leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by His hand He leadeth me.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of God's Holy Spirit abide with you now and always. Amen.